Hi, creators. Welcome or welcome back to Academic Phoenix Plus. My name is Monica, and I'm here to show you how to create a fantastical environment using Maya, Photoshop, and of course, rendering it back in Maya. If you are new to 3D, this might be the perfect tutorial for you. In this video tutorial, we're going to go over modeling, UV mapping, texturing, and so much more. If you're new to this channel, I post videos on a weekly basis. Software includes Maya, ZBrush, Substance Painter, and so much more. So if that is your sort of thing, please consider subscribing to Academic Phoenix Plus. So bring out that creativity, open up that software, and let's go ahead and get started in modeling a fantastical environment using Maya, Photoshop, and more. What I wanted to show you guys was this, which has hard surface elements, some organic, and try to build this unique piece. This concept art is by Ivo Nies, and if you guys look him up, he's extremely talented. He creates his really unique assets. That's one. So anyway, he's very talented, and he does concepts, then he models them too, which is pretty wild. The first thing, of course, you need to do is create a project. So I'm going to go to File, Project Window, click on New. I'm going to call this, I have no idea what to call this. Fantasy Environment, that's what I'm calling it. All right, so usually what I do first is just kind of do what's called a white boxing. So you guys might hear that a lot in the industry, which is just like, you're basically just doing a very basic layout so that it gives us an idea where the camera is gonna be, what the size of the environment is gonna be, so on and so forth.
Let's start off by creating a cylinder. Let's open up the inputs and go to subdivision axis and select the text and the middle mouse and drag and change that to 6, just like the concept art.
So I'm just gonna crush them. And what I usually do is turn on occlusion. If your computer can handle it, I would probably go ahead and turn that on because that's gonna show you an artificial occlusion. So it tells you how close and how far away you are from the actual environment. And then just kind of duplicate it. I'm just going to do a really basic one. Then there's another one over here, but it's way bigger. And then we have a bunch of rocks. So again, it's just a white box. So I'm just going to kind of create this square and just kind of lay it out as like a wall. And do you guys know about soft select? Has, if you hold down B, middle mouse and drag, you can control the offset. Right, so that's the size of the offset. So I can just kind of push this back. And then I'm just gonna control E. I'm just creating an enclosed environment. So far that's kind of like the basics. Now, if you wanted to have this image inside, you can go to create free image plane, and then you go to the attributes, you go to this little folder. You can use this as a reference as well. Some people will use this with the camera. So for example, I can go to create camera, and I can look through it, panels look through selected. I'm going to turn on my resolution gate. So the idea is that I have this, which is basically going to be my render cam. And I can use this render cam to kind of place everything accurately. So if you guys are ever working in the industry and they give you like an environment like this, for example, and they're basically are like, you need to model exactly like it, then you need to use this as a reference image. So another thing I need to do is change my resolution gate to match this image plane. So if I go to my render settings, let me go to my desktop. I'm gonna go to the properties. Let's see, it's 1500 by 706. So what I can do is 1500 by 706. So now this is going to be the same height and width. Okay. So what I'm trying to do is just get the camera angle correct. So I'm looking at perspective lines to make sure that I can capture that. Let me bring up the
other pieces. So that's the plane that I want them to be. So again, this is just kind of white boxing. The only thing I'm doing is just trying to match my reference image as best as I can. Now, if I can get the right angle, then I'm going to be in really good shape. Pretty close, not 100%, but it's close. And you'll notice that I'm not moving them up and down because I already know this is on a plane. Like this is the This is the ground plane or the water. So if as long as I leave them here, it should be okay. And I'm actually going to relabel this ground plane. I'm just kind of pushing things back because the image plane is blocked. Like I want it to be pretty far, like around here. This is going to be the cave. So I just want to make sure it's far enough so I can just push this even further. Whoops, wrong one. I can push this one further back and then scale. All right, so that's getting there. Something like that. Okay, so far we've done just the basic white blocking. We created an image plane. We've added a couple of these key pieces that help make the environment feel like it's starting to go somewhere. We also have water, and this is going to be where our rocks are going to be shaped. So basically we have a little bit of white boxing going on right now. Now, one of the things I don't want to move is my camera. So if you select your camera, and right now I'm looking at camera one, I'm going to double click on this and just call it my render cam. Just because I know this is the one I want to look through, I'm going to lock it. So up here at the top, there's a lock. So now I can't move it, which is great. Most of my work is going to happen is in perspective. It's always kind of fun to see how everything's looking. So you can see that even though I have my water and everything look like it was connected, it's not. So it's one of those things that we have to always double check to make sure that everything is intersecting and that there's no gaps and things like that. But in general, it seems to be doing okay. So these shapes, what I recommend when it comes to modeling is that if it sticks in or out more than an inch, I would say go ahead and model it. If it's less than an inch, I would say just go ahead and detail it out in a texture. Another method you can talk about is actually the silhouette. Does it impact the silhouette? So when you take a look at the silhouette, this line here doesn't really affect the silhouette. I can do that with the texture, but this little notch right here, that affects the silhouette. So therefore, I'm going to make sure that I add that in there. This is a really simple shape. I mean, it's literally like a square. So let me go ahead and get a cube here. And to be fair, it just looks like it's one of these. Just gonna whoop. This just seems to be pretty, except for the bottom. It looks like there's a little, actually, now that I'm looking at this, it has a flat here and then it goes. So that being said, I can insert an edge. And since I have this reference plane, I can try to get the correct width and height and everything based on this graphic. So I'm gonna double click and just kind of move this down. And then insert edges here and here. I'm thinking of multiple ways I can tackle this. I'm just gonna add a couple of small edges here. And then just grab this face and push it in. And that seems to be it. Maybe skinnier. And slightly wider. Okay, let me work in two panels. So let's go to layout. Oh, this is actually pushed back. All right, so this is where it gets interesting, because if I was following things correctly, it should kind of align easily, but instead it looks really large, so that means I have to scale. But if I scale, it's not the same size as this. This is fairly close and large. Do I just want to scale and kind of fool the perspective camera? Or do I make sure that it's accurate, but and then I have to push everything back? So suddenly the environment becomes really large. Right now, I'm just going to try to fool the camera a little bit. So theoretically, it's supposed to be next to here. So this is actually really, I modeled it really large. And this needs to be back here. Sorry, I'm concentrating. I'm like super quiet suddenly. Sorry, because I'm focused. So this plane here has this really close to it. Then it's got this one. Then it's got these two further back. So that's what I'm trying to capture here, is like, how close is this in comparison to the drawing versus my geometry. Okay, so, and then the second one is interesting. And, you know, to be fair, the artist, you know, this isn't a photograph, so I'm sure he took some liberties. So that's another thing that we have to also consider, is this accurate to what he designed? Because a lot of the times they take their own liberties. So it's really important to kind of keep that into consideration. So that we are going to have to take some artistic freedoms. All right, let's see. I know there's another one here. It's supposed to be right next to the rocks. Yep, and then the environment eats it up. So that could mean that this one is too far away, which it is. So I'll just bring it up closer. And then this one, I can just kind of scoot forward and down a little bit. Okay. So let's grab everything and let's center the pivot, delete the history, freeze the transformation. So if I accidentally move it, I can always zero it back. I personally like to see my renders. So I'm going to add a Arnold Light physical sky. And then I'd like to make sure everything's active and see if it's starting to look like the render. I feel this one's kind of close, but the other ones are okay. So we still have a pathway. And we also have the cave. I'm going to focus this on the pathway next. I'm going to go ahead and extrude it just so I know that it's going to be the same exact thickness. And when I transition into it, it'll be easy for me to UV map it and texture it. So I'm going to, again, just kind of follow the concept art and just kind of extrude. And at least try to follow the concept art. It's a little hard to read sometimes. Over here. Okay, I'll just grab an edge. Push it this way. Extrude. Grab the edge. E. Push this one back a little bit. Extrude this one again. And then one more. Push this forward like so. And then for this one, let's extrude forward. And then I'm just going to make it into a point, something like that. So let me take a snapshot of this. Pink. And then see what that looks like. I'm gonna just do some basic coloring just so I can get a little bit more looking like the render. So I always use AI standard surface shaders. So this is gonna be the water shader. And it's kind of boring looking at gray the whole time. Boring. So we got something a little lighter, and this is going to be a regular kind of like concrete. So we'll just add another standard surface. So I'll just make it lighter. This is going to be metal. So I'll just grab these guys. And I don't want to bore you guys with labeling everything. I should be labeling everything, but I'm not. Because there's nothing exciting as you go, all right, pillar one, pillar two, pillar three. You know, it's like, who wants that? Nobody. Let me add a Arnold AI standard surface. Rock shader. And this can be, again, I'm just going to color pick. Oof, that's a little strong. And for the metal, since it's easy in Arnold to make this metal, I'm just going to go in and just make it metallic. I am going to increase the roughness a little bit, but that's going to help make it feel a little bit more metal-like. And everything else needs to be pretty rough because rock is rough and so is concrete. So I'm going to go ahead and increase the roughness there. And the water can be reflective. So I'm going to reduce the roughness for the reflections of the water. So it's kind of giving us the look, right? So, I mean, we have a ways to go, but at least it's starting to come together. So I have to finish the sidewalk and I'd like to start building this cave, but then we have to talk about the rocks because the rocks are actually an important part. So let me finish this sidewalk here and then we can talk about the rocks. All right, let's see. Let me finish this one. Like it just goes off the edge here.
All right, I think that's a really great place to stop. We covered a lot. We've done the path, the water, the pillars. We've got everything laid out in perspective. So now it's just about continuing adding the details such as the rocks, the tree, the cloth. We're going to be using alpha to create that frailed edging. I can't wait. There's so much to show you. I can't wait to show you more.
Thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. If you liked it, please like and subscribe. That's your message to me, letting me know that you like this content and that you want to see more. And also share my videos. That helps me out. It encourages me to make more content like this, and it also helps the YouTube algorithm. Don't forget to take a look at academicphoenixplus.com. There you will find free e-sources such as ebooks, videos, reference images, and more. So take a look at academicphoenixplus.com. Again, thank you so much for watching. I really appreciate it. Keep creating, and I will see you next time in the next video tutorial. And since you're still here, what animation is the background from? If you can recognize it and writing in the comments, I will give you a digital medal. Just a little fun thing to do. All right, I will see you next time.